Well, hello, folks, and welcome to a very special concert here on January 2nd, 2021. And you notice that I haven't been able to shed my Christmas tree yet. I've just had so many visitors here in my little COVID apartment that I haven't had time to take things down. But, you know, I'd like to stay in the spirit of the holidays for as long as we can make that happen. And tonight's performer is... has been with us since the very beginning of Common Ground on the Hill in 1995, and he has been just an amazing contributor to our work and our fun. This is a person who has many, many, many friends and manages to make each one of us feel very special. Guy Davis is known as being a blues man. He's also, I would say, you'd have to say that he's a folk musician as well. And he is a world traveler. He's received many, many awards. And we're going to have a little chat later on in the concert. But lest you tune out because you see this guy thinking it's still Christmas here on your screen, and you're tempted to tune out, don't tune out, because right now I welcome the amazing musician Guy Davis.
Hello, Walt. Hello, everybody, especially folks who are part of Common Ground on the Hill. I'm a lonely fella, I don't get out much, so thank you, Walt, for letting me do this musical presentation. Reach over, get a guitar, got like a whole heap of guitars around me, but guitars ain't the same as having friends, right up where you can see them. I'm gonna start out with a song I wrote called Sugar Belly. Tell you the story of a young girl named Sugar Belly. She was born more than 100 years ago in East Texas. She was a mixed race little girl, half black, half white. Her father had skin as black as this night, and her mother was a white woman of Irish descent with auburn hair and beautiful green eyes. Now, if it were known 100 years ago in East Texas that a black man fathered a child with a white woman, that man would be taken away and killed. So the mother had to be very careful, very secret. She went away inland to have the baby, and she left it at a colored orphanage. When she came home, she said the baby had been stillborn, born dead. That's the way it stayed for a dozen more years, till the orphanage burned down. And about 30 days after that, a little mixed race girl showed up back in the town where she was conceived. Now, ordinarily, when a colored waif shows up in town, there's going to be some black family that's going to take care of that child. Some black family is going to look out for her, make sure she has food, a place to sleep, clothing. But they took one look at Sugar Belly and they shunned her. They turned their backs on her. You see, Sugar Belly had green eyes. She did have one secret benefactor. That was an old black woman they called Grandma. Grandma used to sit in a rocking chair on the front porch of a house just across the street from the dirt lot where Sugar Belly played. Now, the house that Grandma sat in her rocking chair on the porch of was filled with beautiful women. And where there are women, men will come. And each man would take a pack of cigarettes out of his pocket, toss it up on the porch. Grandma would lean down, take a cigarette out of the pack, toss the pack back to the man. That was the signal. He'd come up on that porch. And Grandma would lean back in her rocking chair and wrap her knuckles against that screen door. Women would open that door, let him in there. And after a while, he and one of those young ladies would disappear upstairs. Now Sugar Belly, the little girl playing across the street, she saw all of this. She saw much more than a little girl her age ought to see. But there's one thing Sugar Belly did not see. She didn't see when Grandma took the cigarette out the pack, didn't see Grandma take the money. So Sugar Belly grew up thinking that a woman could be had for a cigarette. And a few years later, when that little girl began to develop like a woman, she went to work in this house. Way down East Texas, more beautiful couldn't be found, was a girl called Sugar Belly, stood 5 feet from the ground. You're the prettiest girl that I ever did see, and I want you to be my Sugar Belly girl. If she had 1,000 lovers, she didn't love not a one, but a jealous lover took her life, and then he cried when he was done. You're the prettiest girl that I ever did see, and I want you to be my Sugar Belly girl. Well, I love you, Sugar Belly, and I want you for my own. Please tell your other men to turn around and go back home. You're the prettiest girl that I ever did see, and I want you to be my Sugar Belly girl. Sugar Belly was upstairs with this old man. He said, sweet mama, squeeze your daddy tight. I got jelly bone jelly, girl, enough to last all night. Prettiest girl that I ever did see, and I want you to be my Sugar Belly girl. Jelly bone jelly, well, they say it can't be wrong. They say that Sugar Belly lasts about 9 months long. You're the prettiest girl that I ever did see, and I want you to be my Sugar Belly girl. Well, a jealous lover grabbed her, she tried to get away. By God and the devil, you are mine, and today's your dying day. You're the prettiest girl that I ever did see, and I want you to be my Sugar Belly girl. Please don't you kill me, she begged with her last breath. But he squeezed his fingers round her throat, and he strangled that girl to death. You're the prettiest girl that I ever did see, and I want you to be my Sugar Belly girl. They heard about it up in heaven right away. Well, his son cried up in heaven, and the moon released her tide. God turned his back to his angels the night Sugar Belly died. You're the prettiest girl that I ever did see, and I want you to be my Sugar Belly girl. Way down past hellfire, who's that knocking on the devil's door? Sugar Belly is mine now, she ain't coming back no more. She's the prettiest girl that I ever did see, and I want her to be my Sugar Belly girl. But 10 angels had dropped down from heaven. It was they who knocked on Satan's door. But upon getting turned away, 9 of them returned back to heaven. But one angel stood his ground. He stood there staring at that door. He took a deep breath, and he kicked down the devil's door. He said, in death her curse is lifted. She will stay with you no more. And he took Sugar Belly by her hand, and he raised her up, up, up past the surface of the earth, up past the clouds, up past the moon, the stars, up past the sun, up to that place they call heaven. And nobody knows if it was a day later or a week, another woman in that house started going by the name Sugar Belly. Then other women in other houses started going by the name Sugar Belly. Even little schoolgirls would tease one another. One might call another one Sugar Belly. And a fella might come home after a long, hard day working in the fields, and he'd call out to that house, Sugar Belly, Sugar Belly, Honey, where you been so long? I've been on the road, I've been on the rail, trying to get back home. You're the prettiest girl that I ever did see. And I want you to be my sugar belly girl. You're the prettiest girl that I ever did see. And I want you to be my sugar belly girl. The story of Sugar Belly. Tonight's concert is very special for me. Of course, we lock ourselves up in our houses and we're shuffling around in the most ridiculous sets of pajamas you've ever seen. At least some of us are. I won't name any names. But tonight I wanted to get dressed up special for you and for me too. Even my girlfriend's, you know, she's dolled up so we can, you know, be sociable. She's many miles away from me. That's Rhonda. Well, let's pick up another git fiddle here. I want to do a song called On the Other Side of the Clouds. It's the song I use as the theme of my Coffee with Kokomo show that I do every morning but Saturdays. I'll tell you about that in a moment. On the other side of the clouds. Sung that. It's been a theme for something like 238, 39 shows. The show I do is called Coffee with Kokomo. It's on my Kokomo Kidd Facebook page. And we have chat, we have banter, we try to catch up almost like it's a real coffee shop. Even got my own coffee mug that I showed to people. Coffee with Kokomo there. And anybody is welcome in this cafe. You can just come on in there, have coffee. And even if it's not really coffee, we don't tell. It's time for me to put on my finger picks. And I'm going to do a song that I wrote. I started writing this song years ago, but it didn't really become what it is, what it's supposed to be, until a couple of summers ago when I went to a place called the Greenwood Culture Center. That's in Tulsa, Oklahoma. That was where the Greenwood Race Massacre of 1921 happened. And this song has since taken shape. Called God's Gonna Make Things Over One of These Days. Excuse me, let me get another sip of this.
God's gonna make things over one of these days.
raise me high so my people see. You know God's gonna make things over one of these days. Tell me, what did you learn when you watched my body burn? Song. I guess you could say it's just sort of been cooking in me for a while. It had to come out. That's one thing I've learned, you know, being at Common Ground on the Hill. That's the place to come to get it out. I enjoy all this time that I've spent going down, seeing friends, Walt in particular, because I've known him the longest time, I guess before there actually was a Common Ground. I remember being in Walt's place out there in the countryside and having conversations with him and him being really excited about it. So I'm glad it came to be. Look at all the people I've gotten to meet. All right, let's put this down. I'm going to play one more tune before we take a break. I know there's a break coming, or they've got me recorded talking. Loath as I am to talk. Since I rarely run my mouth. Okay. I'm going to do a piece I wrote called Railroad Story. This is part of a one-man show I wrote called The Adventures of Fishy Waters in Bed with the Blues. Get a little water to go out. Once upon a time, there was a fella standing by the railroad track. He's waiting for a train. Heard that whistle blow. That train was highballing through the countryside. Stood there beside the track, watching that train go by. It was going so fast he couldn't get on board. He just stood there watching the cars go by like that. And he waited till the train slowed down, making a turn. When it made that turn, he ran alongside and he hopped on board and he was highballing with that train passed on by a farm, had some chickens out on that farm. Those chickens were having an egg-laying contest. They wanted to see who could lay the most and the biggest. Eggs. More than one. And they all had an attitude, a chicken attitude. A train passed on by the chain gang, had the prisoners standing out there shackled ankle to ankle. The sun made the sweat glisten on their backs as they held the picks up high and the shovels down low. They were building a road and they hated it. The work was too hard, the sun was too hot, the bosses were too cruel. And when the guards had their backs turned, a couple of them escaped. They ran out and they crossed that swamp with water up to their necks, past snakes, past alligators. When they got over to the road on the other side and went to catch the train, oh, didn't matter how far they ran, didn't matter how fast they ran, they turned the dogs loose on them. And you know those bloodhounds were hungry. Train kept moving on down that track. The convicts were running after that train. The dogs were coming after the convicts. Now the train track ran right through the middle of a pig farm, and then a pen on the right hand side of the track had some pigs running around out there. Woo! And then the pen on the left hand side, well, those pigs over there weren't so lucky. They was having a barbecue over there. The smell wafted up out of there, blew back over the train, over the tracks, over the convicts, right into the dog's nostrils, drove those bloodhounds crazy. Where the train get moving on, and I tried, the convicts ran as fast as they possibly could after that train, and the dogs were gaining. I'm getting closer and closer and closer and closer. The convicts ran, and they got to the edge of the pits where the pigs were, and they saw the pen over the right hand side, and they leaped right into that pen. Woo! And the dogs chased them and chased them and chased them and leaped, and the dogs landed in the pen right on the left hand side. Well, the train kept going on down the track with nobody to chase after. It just kept going down the track until it vanished out of sight. If you look real careful, you can see just a little tiny puff of smoke coming off of top of it. If you were closer, it would sound different. It would sound like this. Thank you.
Wow, those are some great songs, Guy. And it's so good to hear you. And we're all locked away and feeling disconnected. And this is the way we connect. And you know, I was wondering this morning, in thinking about talking with you about your music, you were influenced by a number of things as you grew up. You grew up in a very interesting community with your folks and all the people that are that were part of their lives and consequently your life. And I wonder how, with, you know, with all the different cross currents of music that must have been happening in your household, and I believe that wasn't Dizzy Gillespie a good friend of your dad's?
I can't say for sure about Dizzy Gillespie how good a friend he was to my dad, but I do recall meeting him.
Yeah. Well, now, so there was a lot of jazz going on, I would assume. And I wonder, like, how did the son of people all mixed up in jazz music end up being a folk musician? How did that happen for you?
Oh, buddy, there's no easy way to start this. When I was just under 8 years old, I got a visit from John Seeger, Pete Seeger's brother. Huh. He came to talk to my mom about me going to a summer camp up in Vermont, where they specialized in folk music and archery and riflery and all sorts of crafts and hiking. And that changed my life. Mm. The 5 years I spent at that summer camp, that's where I was introduced to the five-string banjo. I saw a lot of guitars, but I didn't really start taking that up till I was a teenager. Saw violins, mandolins, and I got to hear music by a great American such as Woody Guthrie and Lead Belly, and hear songs like Kisses Sweeter Than Wine, and also Deportees. I got introduced to stuff that was going to serve me for years, and I did not know it at the time.
Wow, what a great opportunity! What a great thing to happen to a young guy or girl.
I think so. But in my home, there was music. There was lots of it, and we listened. We centered ourselves around the radio for entertainment. But mostly, my folks, being actors and writers, had a lot of actors, writers, and directors coming over. Mm. So I got to hear people telling their stories. In fact, storytelling is a strong part of what I do. I mean, when I'm not singing the songs, I'm busy introducing the songs. And you know, I always try to make those intros as goofy as possible.
You do. I seem to recall you have one where you have the Queen smoking a cigarette. So, you know. yeah, and it's interesting as well that you've done a lot of things in musical theater. And one of those things was portraying or playing the role that the great harmonicist. Sonny Terry. You played the role that Sonny Terry developed, right?
Yes, that was in the revival on Broadway of the musical Finian's Rainbow, which was, the topic was a leprechaun following an older fella and his daughter all the way to America because that older fella has stolen the leprechaun's pot of gold. Ah. The old fella and his daughter settle in the mythical land of Missitucky.
Missitucky.
That gives you any ideas about where they're talking about. And, they're on a land of a sort of a white landowner who's not known to treat folks fairly. And by the end of this, he has changed his mind because somehow that pot of gold got magic and turned this white landowner black.
Wow.
And Sonny Terry his only voice was his harmonica. And he stood on the stage playing and a young girl danced all over to the music. And so I got the role that Sonny Terry had.
Oh, that must have been so much fun. And, you know, I can identify somewhat with that. I was asked to do a revival of Folk Say. This was back in the early 90s. The original role was developed by Woody Guthrie and Cisco Houston. So I played those parts, singing these songs for the dancers. They rolled it all into one, so I was having to channel Woody Guthrie and Cisco Houston at the same time. But it was just a great honor and also a great responsibility to carry that work forward, you know.
Walt, if anybody could do that, you could.
Well, I don't know. The director said, that doesn't sound like Cisco Houston.
Any director who would say that needs to go back to class and get more directing lessons.
I guess so, but the thing is, she had directed the original, so I think she knew. Okay. But it was great, and that goes back to that whole thing. What Pete Seeger used to say all the time is that we're all just parts in the chain or links in the chain. We carry things forward. We create new songs. We sing old songs, and they all sort of reverberate within one another. I'd like to ask you about your process in writing songs? Is it a long process? Does it take a spark of inspiration to start one off? Do you carry songs with you a long time before they're finished?
The answer to all three is yes. I have to, if I'm lucky, a song will come to me, it'll gang rush me and just show up in one day, melody and words. But that is not often the process. Sometimes I've got the words and I got to work them over and over, and a good tune will come. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I've got a good tune, but no words that really merit such a beautiful tune. And I have waited for as long as, say, 10 years for a good tune to find its words. Mm-hmm. But between the three of those, I find ways to get music done. And of course, doing other people's songs helps. Because you sort of steal just a bit of inspiration, not more, from the older songs, so you can create new ones. Now, my creative process, I guess I have it designed around me, and that is I want to tell stories. I mean, if you want to hear Luciano Pavarotti, you don't really come to one of my concerts if that's who you're looking for.
Right.
If you're looking for straight out Garrison Keillor, well, you might drop by one or two of my concerts, but I'm trying to find, like my dad said, a new way to say the same old thing. Because songwriters don't come up with really anything new, nor do storytellers anything new. We find a new way to say it brand new.
Yeah. Well, I know there are times, you know, when a melody will happen, it just happens. And you get a sense, well, I'm grabbing that out of the air, but it probably was pre-existent, you know, or a piece of it was. And, you know, the music of the spheres, I mean, I think it's all right there. And it's, imagine if we can, during this pandemic, what it would have been like, or what it would be like, if we didn't have music. I mean, it's staggering to think about it. And what an amazing gift it is to be human and be able to have that and create that.
Oh God, music to me is the ability to speak sometimes without words.
Yeah.
Melodies has a way of rubbing against the heart that can be felt to a musician such as yourself. I know you know well. But when I can wed the stories, the words to the music, I do. You know, I appreciated that piece that you did. I don't recall the name of it, but it recalled your experiences in the Appalachian territory. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you as a college student, you presented work that contained music that you learned and that you heard, as well as slides and pictures. And you told a story about somebody I didn't know. Well, this is essentially what I want to do. I've got other areas that some of it has to do with my family coming up, but the words, the music, the stories, that's what I want to do.
Yeah, I think it's important too. It's sort of at this phase in our lives to be doing that work, because, you know, there's so many stories that connect our offspring to us that they're not even aware of. So that's important work. And you know what else is important, folks, is to make sure that you see that wonderful backdrop that Guy has there. Now, he has to be able to afford to buy strings. He has to pay rent on that. I don't know if he owns it or he's renting it, but certainly there's some kind of exchange of money. And I want all of you out there to hit that tip jar really big. I mean, big time. Dig deep so that you can keep getting this music and these stories. This has been an outrageously difficult time for lots of people. And certainly among them are the musicians and actors and dancers who devote their lives to this work. So if you've got a little spare change or spare bills hanging around, put them in that tip jar for Guy Davis. And also go to guydavis.com. Is that the right address, Guy?
Yes, it is.
Guydavis.com, and help him out there, and also help yourselves out, because it's going to mean that you're going to be getting more great music from Guy and stories. And you can also see Guy every day, I believe it's almost every day, with the Kokomo Kidd. Now, this Kokomo Kidd is a guy who comes in and he actually he even has his own cup, the Kokomo Kidd. And you can get one of these cups online. and drink coffee with the Kokomo Kidd. And what happens is he sneaks into Guy's apartment and he enters his being for about an hour. And then he leaves Guy dumbfounded with an empty cup of coffee sitting right there in his apartment.
Empty cup of coffee and a lot more laundry. And how this Kokomo Kidd character does that. But this COVID has challenged me in such a way that I think I've become more of who I'm supposed to be, Walt. Mm-hmm. I hate this being locked up and sequestered away from everybody. A friend of mine and I were speculating how two wrestlers get together. They're doing judo flips, but they don't want to let go because it feels so good to be hugged. Please don't let go. Well, anyway, this show has me getting up every day, and I'm challenged to come up with at least two songs, not necessarily new, but often new when I can. And it's sort of like a cafe. We come together, we commiserate, we talk a whole lot of who, a whole lot of hoochie-hoo.
Yeah.
It's good. We complain about politics, and some of us complain too loud and get locked off of Facebook, but that happens too.
Yeah, so this is, so people know, this is on Facebook, the Kokomo Kidd.
Kokomo Kidd Facebook page, and it is called Coffee with Kokomo. And every morning, 10 a.m., and supposed to go for 20 minutes, but sometimes I talk and it goes for 30.
Yeah, and it's K-O-K-O, right? Coco.
Yes, Kokomo. Yeah. K-O-K-O-M-O.
Well, Guy, I'm going to leave you to it. Thank you so much for being with us. Thanks for, you know, your 27 years working with Common Ground on the Hill. And if you ever try to leave, we're going to come kidnap you. So don't even try it.
Thank you very much, Walt Michael, for always being my brother.
Listen, I need brothers, and I count you among my very special brothers. And so be well, stay safe, and let's hear some more music from Guy Davis.
Oh, boy. It was a fun interview to do, Walt. Yeah, and I miss you. I miss you very much. And I know Walt is struggling, and he's aching to see his granddaughter, Wes's little baby girl. My gosh, what a cutie pie. When she was brand new, Walt held her onesie up and took a photo of it and put it on Facebook of Walt holding a onesie. And of course, I immediately said, Walt, it'll never fit you. All right, it's time for us to do some more music. This is a song that I wrote Christmas Day 2014. It was the year my mother died. I wish I hadn't stayed away so long, is the name of the song. And I've told folks that it's about being on the road, being away from home, and you gotta text, a phone call, a message saying you're needed at home right away. But no matter what you do, you cannot get there on time for important things that are happening sometimes. And there's a line in the song says, bell rang on the midnight train carrying the hobos home. Well, I'm one of those hobos. A hobo is somebody who's got to go where the work is. You can't just stay home and do it. So you guys will know what to sing, but please, there in your home, see if you can sing along with me. In a kind of weird way, maybe it'll just make us feel a little bit more together. Stayed away so long. My mother died when I was on the road. My mama died when I was on the road. Bell rang on the midnight train carrying the hobos home. My mother died when I was on the road. Wish I hadn't stayed away so long. Well, I wish I hadn't stayed away so long. I wish I hadn't stayed away so long. Bell rang on the midnight train carrying the hobos home. I wish I hadn't stayed away so long. I got home too late to say goodbye. I got there too late to say goodbye. Bell rang on the midnight train carrying the hobos home. I got home too late to say goodbye. Wish I hadn't stayed away so long. Raise your voices. Well, I wish I hadn't stayed away so long. Yes, I wish I hadn't stayed away so long. Bell rang on the midnight train carrying the hobos home. And I wish I hadn't stayed away so long. The times I've stole away and cried. I can't count the times I've stole away and cried. Bell rang on the midnight train carrying the hobos home. I can't count the times I've stole away and cried. Wish I'd stayed away so long. Singing that. Well, I wish I hadn't stayed away so long. Yes, I wish I hadn't stayed away so long. Bell rang on the midnight train. Bell rang on the midnight train carrying the hobos home. And I wish I hadn't stayed away so long. Stayed away so long. Thank you. That song has meaning to me outside of just my own family. It was also the year that Pete Seeger died. It was 2014. And at one point during Common Ground on the Hill, Lydia Martin, also known as Lydia Sylvia, came on stage with me and sang it. And we had in mind her brother Claude, a young man I first met at Common Ground on the Hill, I think the first year I went there. And I remember having a couple of baseball gloves and a ball and going out with Claude and just tossing that ball back and forth. Anyway, the whole story is a story for another time. It's just that music helps me to reach out, and for that I am grateful. I'd like to do a song now that, a song I heard first time when I was 8 years old. Kisses Sweeter Than Wine. Song was written by Pete Seeger, Fred Hellerman, Lee Hayes, I guess Ronnie Gilbert. I don't know if Ronnie Gilbert's part of the writing part, but Lead Belly apparently had something to do with the writing of this song. Kisses Sweeter Than Wine.
Sweeter than wine.
says sweeter than wine. That song affects me every time I hear it, like a recording of the Weavers or any cover of it. It delights me, I think, the same way it did when I was 8 years old when I first heard it. Not sure why that is. Well, I got a couple of more pieces of music to do. This next one I'm about to do is called Watch Over Me. I haven't decided if I'm supposed to be using my finger picks or not. Let's see. Be my shelter from the storm. Please hold me in your loving arms. I need somebody, someone to watch over me. When I ain't got nothing, when I'm all out and down, I'm 6 feet in the ground. Whoa, I need somebody, someone to watch over me. Well, you know I try to call you, but the wind and through the cold, find nobody, Lord, not to save my soul. Ooh, well, I need somebody, someone to watch over me. My bed, these were the words rushing through my head. Well, I need somebody, someone to watch over me. Listen to me before I go. There's just one thing that I want you to know. Ooh, well, I need somebody, someone. Watch over me. I usually introduce that by saying I used to sing it for my son at night to get him to go to sleep. But I had to stop singing it because he learned it. He'd sing it to me and I'd go to sleep. And God knows where he went. All right. I'm going to get on my finger picks, and I got a piece of music that I guess I'd like to take my performance out with. I want to thank very much all the folks who are watching and listening. I want to thank Maria Wong and Phil Spice for handling, you know, keeping the whole thing coordinated, because I'm just one of these naturally uncoordinatable kind of people. And Walt Michael, a man who's been a dear friend to me for many years. So thank you guys so much for giving me this opportunity and all these opportunities over these many years. All right, he's reaching for a git fiddle. A rolling stone.
Wasn't really where it's at.
taken from you. Everything he can steal. Tell me, how does it feel? Tell me, how does it feel? To be on your own, a complete unknown. Home, just like a rolling stone. Ah, oh, princes in the steeple, and all the pretty people sitting, drinking, thinking that they got it made. Exchanging all precious gifts and things. You better take that diamond ring. You better pawn it, babe. So amused, and the polling and rags and the language that he used. Well, go to him now, he calls you, you can't refuse. When you got nothing, honey, you got nothing left to lose. You are invisible, you got no secrets to conceal. How does it Thank you.